Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. There is one body and one spirit. One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses set out with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. To the elders he had said, "Wait here for us until we come to you again, for Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain, in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the second letter of Peter. We did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we had been eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when that voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. You will do well to be attentive to this as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. First of all, you must understand this, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of the Holy Trinity, one God. Amen. We've all seen the movie or read the book. story of the relationship between a grouch and a high-spirited kid, and the tension between them growing to a dramatic climax, followed by the grouch's transformation into a kindly grandparent and the happy, if tear-inducing, ending. There's always a turning point in this formula where someone's worldview is transformed. They are looking with the same eyes, but something has shifted, and they see what they never saw before. Our scripture readings today tell us that first Moses and then Jesus go on retreat with their closest friends. They have mountaintop experiences. They are transfigured, transformed by their encounter with God, a transformation that is clearly visible to those around them and informs their relationships going forward. Perhaps you can recall an experience of seeing someone in a whole new light, a parent who becomes frail and vulnerable, a friend or a teacher whom you see in an unfamiliar context. Perhaps there was a moment when you saw Christ in someone for the first time. Imagine then what it was like for Peter and James and John to see their rabbi transfigured and in the company of the prophets Moses and Elijah, the legendary heroes of their faith. Of course, they were changed by the experience. And of course, they were startled, terrified even, by the divine voice that proclaimed Jesus to be more than a prophet. This is my son, the beloved. The disciples knew from the stories of Moses that it was dangerous to get too close to God. The Exodus story tells us that the presence of God was like a devouring fire. And now, these three fishermen who walked with Jesus every day were being told that their friend and teacher was, in fact, the presence of God in their midst. These last few weeks, we've been hearing stories of how the mission of Jesus was made known to the people of Israel. At this point in Matthew's gospel, Peter has just acclaimed Jesus as the long-awaited Messiah, only to be told that this Messiah will not liberate Israel from oppressive rule, but will be betrayed and murdered. Now, on the mountaintop, Peter and the others witness a sort of commissioning of Jesus as Messiah by both the ancient prophets and by God speaking from the cloud, just as God had once spoken to Moses from the cloud. The contrast between the ancient Hebrew understanding of God as a dangerous and destructive presence and Emmanuel, the God who comes among us, is driven home by Jesus reaching out and touching the trembling disciples, reassuring them and telling them there is nothing to fear. This is a divine presence that heals, it doesn't hurt. And this experience of God is, in a nutshell, the uniquely good news of our Christian faith, that the all-powerful and transcendent God who made the heavens and the earth is willing to be one of us, to reach out with healing hands and words, to enter into the reality of this broken world so that the light can shine in the darkness. This week, I saw the movie Just Mercy. The plot, based on a true story, revolves around the experience of a newly minted lawyer seeking justice for death row inmates in Alabama. The men on death row live in the Valley of the Shadow. They have foreseen their death, just as Jesus does in the gospel. And some, like Jesus, are innocent of any crime. Just Mercy opens with one of the main characters cutting down a tree and gazing up at the revealed gap, meditating on the serene beauty of the surrounding treetops waving in the breeze with a brilliantly blue sky behind them. Later in the movie, in a particularly dark and painful moment, the same character, now a death row inmate, closes his eyes and relives that vision, which he has mentally stored away for just such a moment as this. What have been your mountaintop experiences? When have you glimpsed the glory of God? Surely most of us have some memory of a shining moment that sustains us in difficult times. The nature of a mountaintop experience is that it is fleeting. However much we, like Peter, try to hold on to it, the music ends, the flower fades, the surprise becomes routine, and sooner or later we have to come back down the mountain to face reality. Jesus is the beloved Son of God, but that doesn't change the grim fate that awaits him. He and the disciples must still walk on to Jerusalem, sustained by the memory of that mountaintop moment, strengthened in their vision of the kingdom of God, a world where love and justice and wholeness prevail over hatred and greed and prejudice. If we can enter into the Transfiguration story and put ourselves in the place of the disciples, we too can experience the healing touch of Jesus. We too can hear him say, "Get up and do not be afraid." We too can draw on the shining certainty that the kingdom of God is among us, not only in those transfiguring moments, but potentially in every moment, if we only pay attention. We can be changed by this encounter, changed so that we become true disciples, walking in the footsteps of Jesus, seeking to become like him, casting his vision for others and making it real. In Just Mercy, the young lawyer is changed by his work with the death row inmates. He has been chastened and abused, his heart broken, his expectations dashed by experience. The law and justice don't always coincide. The systemic racism is deeply embedded. He has witnessed suffering that he couldn't have imagined, but he has seen the face of Jesus in those inmates on death row. And so he keeps on keeping on. Last weekend at the Diocesan Leadership Academy, our own Christian Gillette, newly hired canon for evangelism and discipleship, asked us to consider if being a Christian and being a disciple are the same thing. Discipleship is challenging. It's easy to come to church, but much harder to actually change your life in the pursuit of learning to be like Jesus. The hard question for each of us is, how much do I want to be like Jesus? What am I willing to give up? Is that vision of a just and peaceful world, of abundant life for every human being, beautiful enough to make me change my life? At this point in the church year, just before Lent, we are gazing down a wilderness path that leads to the cross. It's the toughest 6 weeks of the year. Some people may stop attending church. Some may stay away in Holy Week. And some will walk all the way with Jesus, because the vision that he holds out to us is so compelling, so glorious, that we will endure the discomfort and the darkness and the guilt of being part of that crowd who shout, "Crucify him," for the sake of bringing that vision just a little closer to reality. For the lawyer in Just Mercy, his gospel vision of justice called him to persevere, to fight, to keep going regardless of threats and abuse, until his client was exonerated. And even then he didn't stop. His organization, the Equal Justice Initiative, continues to work today on behalf of those who don't have access to legal counsel. This, our journey of faith, will give us moments, mountaintop experiences, when someone or something is transfigured and we gain a new insight. But most of the time, we'll be down in the valley, trudging doggedly in the footsteps of our Savior. And with each step, we will come closer to personal transformation, to the glory that will transfigure you and me. So put on your sandals, Take up your walking stick. It's time to set out for Jerusalem.
The candidates for holy baptism will now be presented. Will you be responsible for seeing that the child you present is brought up in the Christian faith and life? Will you, by your prayers and witness, help this child to grow into the full stature of Christ? Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God? Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love? Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord? Will the congregation, priests, please stand? Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ? Let us join with those who are committing themselves to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers? Will you persevere in resisting evil? And whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord. Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ? Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself? Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let us now pray for these persons who are to receive the sacrament of new birth.
Deliver them, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open their hearts to your grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill them with your holy and life-giving spirit. Keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church.
Lord,
teach them to love others in the power of the Spirit.
Lord,
send them into the world in witness to your love.
Lord,
bring them to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord,
Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. In it, your Son Jesus received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. By it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who here are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Blair, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Blair, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever.
Receive the light of Christ.
Conan, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Conan, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen.
Amen. Receive the light of Christ. Ah, it's all right. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit, you have bestowed upon these, your servants, the forgiveness of sin, and have raised them to the new life of grace. Sustain them, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give them inquiring and discerning hearts, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Amen. Let us welcome the newly baptized, saying together, we receive you into the household of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us in his eternal priesthood.
Thank you.
peace of the Lord be always with you.
Good morning. My name is Penny Bridges. I serve as the Dean of St. Paul's Cathedral, and it's my joy to welcome you this morning, whoever you are and wherever you find yourself in the journey of faith. Please know that you are most welcome to participate in all that we do here at St. Paul's. God's table is open to everyone. And at communion time, as you come forward, if you wish to receive the sacrament, put your hands together, one on top of the other. If you prefer to receive a blessing, cross your hands at your shoulders. And if you require a gluten-free wafer, those will be available over here by the large oil painting. If you are concerned about the various viruses that are going around, it's perfectly fine to pass on the wine. It is fortified wine in a silver cup, and so it's very safe, but I want everyone to feel comfortable. So if you want to, just cross your arms when the chalice comes your way, and you'll still receive the full spiritual benefit of the sacrament. It's a special joy to welcome our two baptismal families and two new members of the body of Christ and all of your friends. It's great to have you here with us today. And a special welcome to all our visitors. I hope you'll let us know who you are. Introduce yourself after the service. We have a greeter's table, a welcome table right outside the door in the courtyard where you can let us know a little about yourself and receive a gift to remind you to come back and see us again soon. If you're celebrating a birthday or an anniversary this week, I invite you to stand as I say a prayer for you. Anniversary, how many years? 19th anniversary, okay. Alan, a birthday? 89. Okay, yeah. Anyone else? Oh, Richard, birthday? And a few others. And an anniversary of the blessing of the marriage. Yes. Let us pray. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Congratulations and many happy returns to you all. Following this service, we have a special event. As it's the last Sunday before Lent, we are going to have a pancake tournament and race. It's newly expanded this year, so I don't know exactly what the course looks like, but somebody's going to tell us. And there is a pancake breakfast. You're welcome to make a donation and stay for the pancake breakfast or just enjoy your coffee and fellowship as usual. Be sure to buy your tickets for the Zydeco reception. On Tuesday, Shrove Tuesday, we have our annual unique tradition of the Zydeco Mass with beads and Zydeco music and masks and costumes. It's a really wild service. It's great fun, and the church is always very crowded, and everyone is welcome. And then there is a ticketed reception, a dinner of New Orleans food following the service. So the Zydeco Mass is at 6, and I think tickets will be on sale in the courtyard after this service. Of course, after Shrove Tuesday comes Ash Wednesday, the beginning of Lent, and we'll be sending teams out across the city to do Ashes to Go. And there'll also be services here at 7:30 a.m. and at noon and at 7 p.m. And all of the services will include the imposition of ashes. So hopefully you can get to one of those or come and find us on a street corner downtown and get your ashes to go. Please sign up for our Lent formation programs. There are a couple of offerings. There's the confirmation class, or the What is an Episcopalian class, and there's a book study using the last week, a book by Marcus Borg and John Dominic Crossan. That study will be off-site at Merrill Gardens, just three blocks from here, and all are welcome. Don't forget to pick up your booklets. The Lent meditation booklets are in the porches. We have a meditation for each day of Lent that was written by a member of the parish. Lots of different people participated, and those books are available now for you to take home. Next weekend is Night Watch for the Youth of the Diocese, and you can sign up for that today. That's an overnight here in the cathedral. It's a wonderful experience for our young people. Coming up in about 10 days is our monthly Women Together program of dinner and a speaker, and you can sign up for that today as well, again in the courtyard. And I want you to note the notice about lay delegates. Our diocesan convention doesn't happen till November, but we are to elect lay delegates at this time of year. So chapter will be electing 6 lay members of the cathedral to be our delegates to convention at their March meeting. So if you are interested in that ministry, seek out one of the clergy or one of our former delegates if you want to know more, and submit your name and a paragraph about why you feel called to that ministry to Kathleen Burgess, our administrator, by the end of this week, please, by the 28th, so that chapter can consider your name and make their election. You will hear, we are going to sing at the offertory in a moment. We are going to sing Lift Every Voice and sing the Black National Anthem. We've been asked by one of my fellow deans to sing this today. We're trying to have 120 churches and cathedrals across the country singing this hymn. It's the 120th anniversary of it being written. And of course, it's the final Sunday in Black History Month as well. So I hope you will sing with gusto in a few minutes. It's a great, great hymn. And thank you to our chapter members and officers for a wonderful retreat on Friday night and yesterday. We had a very good time, and it was a packed agenda. We got a lot done, and I'm very excited about the year ahead. And one last thing to sign up for is 40 items in 40 days. You can pick up a bag and discard one item each day of Lent that you don't need anymore, and then on Palm Sunday, bring them in, and we will donate all of those items to people who can still use them. Please stand as you're able.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Blessed.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. And a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given to you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death and proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming, Lord, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Paul, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation.
By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
not of the church, but of Jesus Christ. It is made ready for those who love him and who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith, and you who have little, you who have been here often, and you who have not been for a long time or ever before, you who have tried to follow, and you who have failed. Come not because the church invites you. It is Christ, and he invites you to meet him here. The gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Eternal God,
you have graciously accepted us
as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food, the sacrament of his body. Send us now the world of peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord.
In the name of this congregation, I send you forth bearing these holy gifts, that John Davis may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. We who are many are one body because we all share one bread and one cup.
And now live without fear. Your Creator has made you holy, has always protected you, and loves you as a mother. Go in peace to walk the good road, and may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Thank you.
forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Amen.